Charlie Tremendous Jones made a statement years ago that has resonated in my heart, and I want to share it with you. He said you could change your life by three things: the places you go, the people you meet, and the books you read. The places you go, the people you meet, and the books you read. You don't want to just hang out in Tulare County the rest of your life. Get on a plane. Go somewhere. Punch your neighbor and say, go somewhere. I've had the privilege, Karen and I have had the privilege of traveling quite a bit to other countries. And I wanted to share with you three of those experiences this morning because they became life-changing experiences. I'll never forget the time I was in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. We were going up Sugarloaf, and you know the Christ the Redeemer, the huge white cross of Christ the Redeemer overlooking Rio de Janeiro. I wanted to go up there and see what's up. My preacher friend and I, we went up the gondola, and we got up there and looked around and did not know this, but there was a little chapel underneath the huge cross. And we went over there, and it probably wouldn't seat 12 people. And it was open, and it was run by the Catholic Church. And so I asked the lady at the door, would it be okay if I go in? Go ahead. My preacher friend and I walked in and just sat down on the front row, and all of a sudden, the presence of God just took my breath away. And for the next 30 to 45 minutes, I sat in silence, just wanting to revere the moment in the presence of God. How many know what that's like, being in the presence of God? And I walked out scratching my head. I'm thinking, this is a Catholic church. It doesn't move like that in the Catholic church. All of a sudden, my mind changed. God can be God anywhere. It doesn't matter if it's the Baptist church, the Catholic church, the Pentecostal church, any church. I remember boarding a plane on my way to Durban, South Africa, and I was praying a prayer. I said, Lord, I feel in my spirit there's more that you want to do with me, with our church. And no sooner had I landed in Durban, South Africa, met a businessman, and he said, why don't you go with me? And he took me to the largest concentrated area of AIDS in the world, in the most beautiful country of Africa, South Africa. Went there, and lo and behold, took me to a hill, took me to a mountain among the Zulu tribe. And all of a sudden, God began to download on me, this is more. I want you to get involved here and help these people. Now, that's been 5 years ago. We not only built a church there, built a clinic. The chief has come and give us a second mountain and wants us to duplicate the same thing we did over there and did here. Because how many know that when Christians get involved in compassion, we change the world? We change the world. A couple of weeks ago, I was in Turkey. I was called alongside with another 10 or 12 pastors from the Southern California area to try to help minister to the refugee problem in Turkey. You see, the Middle East is riddled with so many wars in Iran and Iraq and Syria and Turkey. People have just run to Turkey to get away from war. I told you last week about the young lady that I met that was just sitting in her university studying, and all of a sudden ISIS began to shoot up the university. She ran for her life. And before I got on the plane, I began to pray. I said, Lord, we're headed into some areas that's 100% Islamic, and I have to tell you, I do not understand your heart for Islam. Please give me an understanding. Give me your heart for Islam. Teach me Islam. Boy, was I in for some surprises of my life. We met a lot of people, and we're going to help these people. But I want you to hear this one testimony of this young lady right here. We couldn't show her face, but you can hear her story.
I am from Syria, Aleppo. I used to live there with my family. Yeah, and when all the problems started, we had to move to Latakia because it was much more safer. And then we decided we want to like better life. So we wanted to come to Turkey, and we came to here 3 years ago.
Were you a Christian when you came?
No, I
wasn't. Were you Muslim?
Yeah.
Muslim family.
Yes.
And tell us a little bit about how you, we're sitting here in a refugee center here in Ankara.
Yeah.
And this was your first exposure to Christianity?
Well, I used to come here to receive Eid just like any normal refugee who came to this building. But then I felt like I wanted to do something. So I came and I was like very brave. And I said, I want to do that. I want to work with you. And they were really nice to me. They said, yeah, sure, you can do it. So I started to come every week to help with the distribution and things like that. I saw them all praying together and reading the Bible and talking about Jesus. I feel like there is a lot of things I misunderstanding before. But then I got like the clear view about it. So I started to read more and learn more, and that's how it touched my heart. Yeah, that's how I became like Christian.
What would you say to someone who really could help? Let's say, what would you say to me if you were trying to get me to help the Syrian people, the refugees? What kind of help can we provide for you?
It's really miserable here. The Syrian life here is really bad. A lot of people are looking for jobs and ways to like support their family, and they can't find anything. I mean, they need money, they need to stay warm.
Yeah.
I just wish that I see like all the Syrian family who came to here, and sometimes I feel more emotional to them because I know what they were through. So sometimes they ask for things, we usually don't do it, but I see myself actually doing it for them because I know, I really know what they have been through. And I really wish that here we could like give, like for swing project is really perfect for them. A lot of refugee women came to here because they're learning new stuff. They're earning money of it, and for English courses, Turkish courses, that's really good for the food. I mean, it's need to be more for them. I mean, box for only 1 week, that's not really enough.
Yeah.
They really need more.
Yeah.
Yeah. It wasn't really easy for me. I had like a really hard time, but when I came to here and I read more in Bible and became more close to God, everything became more easy to me.
How has Christ changed your life?
Before I was really desperate because I was waiting without any hope that we will go to Canada, and I left my college in Syria, I left all my friends in Syria. So he bring the hope again.
You shared with me earlier that you have a dream of what you want to do with your life. Since you've come to Christ, you have a passion to do something. Remind me what that was.
I want to be a nurse, and I want to keep working for like organizations, because living through all this made me wanted to do something really helpful for all the refugees. It doesn't matter if they are Syrian, African, all around the world. Anyone who needs help, I just feel like I want to help them.
Yeah, God's put that in your heart,
yeah.
Hasn't he? Yeah. And we will pray that God will fulfill that. It's going to be exciting to see how God uses you. Thank you for sharing with us.
That was one of about 4 million people that are crammed into Turkey right now, just middle class, upper class people that got ran out of their country with just the clothes on their back because of war and what's going on there. I left and I had a friend with me, and we told him we'll be back. We will bless this refugee center. We will bless the radio broadcast. We will get deeply involved in this, and you'll be hearing more about that to come. But you know, I want to make sure that we all have a clear understanding. Recently, this young man walks into the mosque in New Zealand, and he kills 50 Muslims, and he injures about 50 others. That is not us. That is not us. What you saw in this video, this is us. We're into compassion and for all people all around the world. And how do you untangle such a terrible knot? You know, if you look at the Middle East today, there are three major religions. Or Christianity is the largest, Islam second, and then Judaism for Jewish people. Presidents and leaders throughout decades have tried to go over there and solve the crises, and how can the Arab world get along with the Jewish settlements? And thousands upon thousands have given their lives. Millions have been displaced, run away from their home. And yet, we know one thing, war is not the answer. We know that, it's not solved anything. So everybody else has given you a roadmap, but I'm gonna give you my roadmap from the Bible this morning. I want to teach you three or four things here. If you're taking notes, I want you to write this one down, because I want you to understand that the house of Ishmael has a purpose, just like the house of Isaac. You may not know much about that, but I want to share a couple of verses here with you, because Abraham had two sons. The first one was Ishmael, and the second one was Isaac. The first one he had was with his maidservant, and his real son that he had was Isaac, that was with his wife Sarah, but he had a maid named Hagar, and they had a son. So Ishmael's the son of Hagar, Isaac is the son of Sarah. And this is what happened one day. Sarah got mad at Hagar because Ishmael was making fun of her, and Ishmael was driven out of the house of Abraham and forced to go to the desert. And this is what we're going to pick up the reading there. This is what God said about Ishmael. Genesis 17:20, "As for Ishmael, I've heard you. I will surely bless him." Think about this. God said, "I'm going to bless Ishmael." I don't know if you know this, Islam comes from the word Ishmael. "I'm going to bless Ishmael. I will make him fruitful and greatly increase his numbers." This is God speaking. "He will be the father of 12 rulers, and I will make him into a great nation. I will make the son of a maidservant," in Genesis 21, "I will make the son of Hagar into a nation also, Abraham, because he's your offspring." So, I don't know if you know much about the geography of the Middle East, but I want to show you here on the map the 12 tribes of Ishmael. We always hear about the 12 tribes of Israel. You see the circle over there. But the Bible said in Genesis 25, Ishmael's descendants will settle all the way from Havilah to Shur. Shur, Saudi Arabia, all the way over to Havilah, Iraq, which is opposite of Egypt. So this is where the 12 tribes, the 12 sons of Ishmael landed after he was banished to the wilderness, to the desert. So go to the next map and I'll show you. If you can see Turkey in the middle of the map, sort of, you see the Mediterranean, Israel right next to that. So the 12 sons of Ishmael, you start with Palestine, the Jordanians, the Iraqis, the Kuwaitis, the Qatar people, and then you see the United Arab Emirates right below the Persian Gulf there. That makes up the seven other sons of Ishmael, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Hobby Lobby, the rest of those guys. I can't pronounce all those names. So you see Saudi Arabia, you see all of the sons. They're not named after the names in the Bible, but this is where they've landed. And so God said, I will bless this nation. You know, you and I, as Christians, we say the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jewish people say the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But not so with the Islamic. The Arab people would say the God of Abraham, Ishmael, and Naboth, which one of the sons of Ishmael. So I just want to put you in that mindset for a second, because there's 12 groups here and there's 12 groups over here. So look at this next verse, because this is what the angel said about Ishmael. Genesis chapter 16, verse 11, the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, "You're now pregnant. You're going to give birth to a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man." How many know that came true? One translation says he's going to be a jackass. I like that word, jackass. I don't know. I told you to put your kids over there. I told you not to bring them in here. He will be a wild donkey. I used to have a jack. You know, a jack is between a horse and a mule. Man, those are the meanest suckers you'll ever. If you don't tame them, he will be an untamed donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him, and he will live in hostility. This is before he's born. That boy is going to live in hostility toward all his brothers. So, how do you do that? God said, "I'm going to bless him. He's going to be a wild donkey of a man. He's going to be rough to deal with. He's not going to get along with anybody, but he's my child. I'm going to bless him." So smoke that in your pipe this afternoon. So number two, we must understand that the real bone of contention is not land, simply rejection. Rejection. You know that Abraham had to kick him out of the house. And look at Genesis chapter 25 here. It tells us in verse number 18, I believe it is. Ishmael's descendant will live in hostility toward their brothers. He got kicked out of the house, and it's over this thing of rejection. I don't know if you've ever felt rejected. I think you have. I'm pretty sure everybody's felt rejected at one time, because everybody on the earth will feel rejection. Rejection is just a part of life. You go all the way back to Adam and Eve. They had two sons. One was named Cain. One was Abel. It came time to worship the Lord. Abel brought the sacrifice that was prescribed of God. Cain thought he would just satisfy God his own way. And God did not accept Cain's sacrifice, but he took Abel's sacrifice, and Cain felt rejected. And as soon as he felt rejected, the anger began to boil in him. And God just told Cain, you know, "Cain, why are you so mad? If you do the right things, you will be accepted and you will be blessed. If you do the wrong things, you will be rejected and you will not be blessed." And I don't know about you, but I think I know about you. The thing that you and I understand as Christians, the cross of Jesus Christ is the only place that you can heal rejection. No one is exempt from rejection, and no one is excluded at the cross of Jesus Christ. And if you're watching us, I know there's thousands of you that do. If you're listening to me and you are going down the road and you're feeling rejected, you're in a prison cell somewhere and you're feeling rejection, I'm here to tell you there is room at the cross of Jesus for you. He was rejected. You will be rejected. Why don't you just go ahead and accept Jesus, and he'll help you deal with the anger of rejection. So Abraham sends Hagar out into the desert. "You gotta go, girl. You gotta go." And he sent her out there with two items, a canteen of water and a Sloppy Joe sandwich. What a cheapskate, Abraham. Now, here's the problem. Here's where rejection comes in. Ishmael was supposed to receive the major part of Abraham's inheritance, and Abraham was one rich dude. Now he gets nothing, and he gets banished to the desert, and now he is feeling with rejection like nobody's business. And it's the same conflict between the Arabs and the Jews today. You don't belong here. You get out of here. It's that rejection. That's my land. Why did you take my land? Well, that inheritance belongs to me. Give it back to me. Get out of here. Even though Ishmael was rejected, God gave him the riches of the Middle East. I don't know if you know anything about Saudi Arabia and all the Iraq and all that. They're loaded with minerals and oil, richest countries in the world. Fortunately for Ishmael and Hagar, God didn't dismiss them. God said, I will bless them. Look at this verse here, Genesis chapter 21. God was with the boy. I hope you're getting this in your spirit. You can't say that God is not with the Islamic people. God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. Now, if God is in the business of accepting Ishmael, embracing people, and I think it's probably a pretty good idea that you and I do the same thing. Why? Because rejection is a dead-end street. You get out of here. You don't believe like I do. Go to hell. You don't even deserve what I got. No, no, no. That's a wrong conversation. The totally wrong conversation. And we got to, as Christians, believe this. I want you to write number three down because this is the turning point. We must not relegate Jesus just to Christianity. And let me explain that. Jesus was Jewish. He grew up in a Jewish synagogue. He had Jewish parents, and he was the Messiah that was prophesied in the Old Testament. Stay with me for a second. I just want to teach you a little bit. Jesus had been prophesied over a period of 1,600 years that he would come and be the Savior of the world. There's like 68 prophecies in the Old Testament written by different people in different places, all put in the same book, and they kept prophesying he's going to be born in a manger. He's going to be born in Bethlehem. He's going to be the king. He's going to die. He's going to resurrect. He's going to be born of a virgin. All kinds of prophecies. Now, the Jewish people, you Jewish people that are listening to me, you need to understand Jesus is the Messiah you've been waiting on. And if you will be strong enough to go back and do a historical search of Jesus dying on the cross and rising again, I know you don't accept him because he didn't come in that neat little box. I know he didn't come the way that you wanted him to come, but I'm telling you, Jewish people, Jesus is the answer because he is the Messiah. He is the Messiah. You missed it. You missed it altogether. And they rejected him for that reason. And the Apostle Paul was the most fervent Jew there ever was. And he's going to Damascus. God knocks him down, takes his sight away for 3 days and say, boy, you need to change your direction. I am the Messiah. And this most devout Jewish man changed everything in a matter of a few days because he ran into the living Christ. My encouragement to you is say, why don't you pray and say, Jesus, if you are the Messiah, I wish you would come and reveal yourself to me. Now, I want to show you this verse. You got time for a long passage of scripture? One lady over there, she and I will read it. Ephesians 2:11, Message Translation. Paul is speaking to the Ephesus church, and he says, he's speaking to Gentiles. These are not Jewish people. He says, don't take any of this for granted. It was only yesterday that you outsiders to God's way had no idea of any of this. Didn't know the first thing about the way God works. Hadn't the faintest idea about Christ. You knew nothing of that rich history of God's covenant and promises in Israel. Hadn't a clue about what God was doing in the world at large. Now, because of Christ dying that death, shedding that blood, you who were once out of it altogether are in on everything. The Messiah has made up things, has made things up between us so that we are now together on this, both non-Jewish outsiders and Jewish insiders. He tore down the wall we used to keep each other at a distance. He repealed the law code that had become so clogged with the fine prints and footnotes that it hindered more than it helped. Then he started over. Instead of continuing with two groups of people separated by centuries of animosity and suspicion, he created a new kind of human being, a fresh start for everybody. Christ brought us together through his death on the cross. The cross got us to embrace each other, and that was the end of the hostilities. Christ came and preached peace to you outsiders and peace to us insiders. Somebody say amen. He treated us as equals, so made us equals. Through him, we both share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. That's plain enough, isn't it? You're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom of faith is now your home country. You are no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here with as much right to the name Christian as anyone else. God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how we got here, then what he is building. He used the apostles and the prophets to lay the foundation. Now he's using you, fitting you in brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as the cornerstone that holds all parts together. Amen, amen. We see this taking shape day after day. A holy temple built by God, all of us built into it, a temple in which God is quite at home. Somebody say, thank God for his word. So I've spoken to the Jewish people. Jesus is the answer. Now I want to speak to the Muslim people. And you know, Muslim people, all of you people that read the Quran, I've read it twice, and I know that you revere Jesus as a great prophet. I know you honor him as a great prophet. I know you honor his mother, Mary, as a great woman of God. And I know that your imams teach you that in the last days, Jesus will come back. And that is true. We Christians believe the same thing. And your imams are teaching that Jesus will come back and lead everybody to Muhammad. But I'm here to tell you, Jesus will come back and lead all of you to God, not to Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. He's going to take you to God. And here's something else. I just need to say this. The Quran denies the crucifixion of Jesus. Oh, that was some bad writing right there. Why? Because we know by historical fact that Jesus not only lived on the earth, but he walked the earth, he died, and he rose again. We know that. We have over 500 witnesses that witnessed him rising in the air. I mean, we have a scholar that wasn't even a born-again believer. His name was Josephus, and he gave us the historical account in that day. He wrote about the history in that day. And he, an unbeliever, has proven to us all by a secular account that Jesus not only died, but he rose from the dead. When you get in your Quran and you get to Surah 3 and Surah 4, and it starts talking about he wasn't crucified, this is what it says. Your Quran says he wasn't crucified. At the last moment, they switched the person to be crucified, and his disciples took another person and let him be crucified, but Jesus they didn't crucify. That is such a wrong. That is so wrong. Your prophet is right in it 600 years after it happened, but I've got people I have writings of people that lived in that day, and yes, he was crucified. And the reason he was crucified, he died for the sins of all mankind, and he rose again in order that you might have power to live a resurrected life. I know this is boring some of you, but we're speaking to a humongous audience here. You know, we have over 7,000 people that listen to us, and I just need everybody to understand what happened in New Zealand and going in blowing up mosque and thing. That's not us. What is us? We are peaceful, loving people. We're hoping that somebody would accept the love of Jesus Christ to change the world. Here's the last one. We need to start feeling each other's pain. I hope you felt the pain of that young lady, a beautiful 27-year-old single gal just minding her own business and got caught up in a war-torn country and didn't know what to do. I wind up with this. When Abraham died in Genesis chapter 25, the Bible says that Abraham gave up his last breath, died a ripe old age, satisfied with life. I prayed you would die satisfied with life. But at his funeral, the two sons come together. Now, Ishmael is 89 years old, and Isaac is 75 years old, and they're both at the gravesite of Abraham, the patriarch of the faith. Both mothers are now gone, the feuding is gone, but these brothers, they came together at their father's grave, and they did what was right by their father in that moment. I would that one day everybody else would just do what's right and come together around Father God and say, you know what? We're going to quit fighting about land. We're going to quit fighting about he said, she said, he did that. And we're going to come around a commonality of God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that who should ever believe in him will not perish but have eternal life. So Muslims, your Quran says Jesus is coming back. Jewish people, your Torah says the Messiah is coming. We Christians are trying to tell you he's already come and we're waiting for him to come back and take us all into heaven. Why don't we just all get together and get along around Jesus? Is this too much to ask or is this too much to expect? You're sitting there in your natural mind, you're saying, no, smarter people than you have tried to figure it out. We sent Jimmy Carter to the Middle East one time. Some of y'all don't even remember knowing who Jimmy Carter is. Is it too much to expect? I got a verse for you right here out of Matthew. The Bible tells us in Matthew right here, with man, can you read this out loud? With man, this is impossible. But with God, let's read it again. With man, this is impossible, but with God, with God, somebody say all things are possible. Maybe we could change the world right here. Maybe we just got around. You know what I'm believing, church? I'm believing that God's going to do something really supernatural here at the end. And he's going to make some things happen. And all eyes are going to look up and they're going to recognize Jesus is the Son of God. And he came for the sins of the world. And that's God's plan. Let me give you this last verse and I'll get out of your way. 1 Peter, this is a good verse. 1 Peter 4, verse 7, Message translation. Peter said, everything in the world is about to be wrapped up. So take nothing for granted. Stay wide awake in prayer. You and I can pray, can't we? We can pray for our Muslims and Jewish brothers and sisters. Most of all, love each other as if your life depended on it. Love makes up practically for anything. I think I'm going to go the love route. How about you? I got to tell you, I went to ask God to give me a greater understanding of Islam. And when I landed, we were carted about with this young lady who was our guide for where we were going. A devout Muslim, very devout, but a Harvard graduate. I've always wanted to talk to an educated Muslim. And I thought, my chance. So one night I sat down, we were having dinner with everybody I sat down with. I said, now, if you don't mind, I want to ask you some questions. And I respect you as a person. I respect your heart for God. It's very evident. And I know you respect my Jesus. But if we could just have this conversation, because we in America, when we look at Islam, we struggle because the Quran has so much violence in it. It's as if, you know, it's you can't get through one chapter or hardly a page without kill the infidel, kill the unbeliever, kill. I said, we struggle with killing because Jesus never killed anybody. I said, and we have a real struggle with the violent side of Islam, and we're nothing like that. She said, oh, that's, you don't understand the 7 degrees of Islam. I said, do tell. She said, oh, the first level of Islam, if you are a disobedient people and you're an unruly people, yes, you need to submit to Sharia law because you're disobedient. She said, but if you'll get over that, you go up to the second level. And she began to explain the third level, the fourth level. She said, when you get to the highest level, you find the love of God. I said, I've never heard that before. And the next day we were all having coffee and all of our preachers, and I thought everybody ought to hear that. So I asked her, I said, would you explain to everybody what you and I were talking about last night about the 7 levels of Islam? So she began, yeah, the first level for the disobedient, da 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 da. She got to, and this level, if you get to this level, you feel the love of God. And she started crying. She started weeping. It was a little moment we're having here. She's weeping. She said, please forgive me. She said, my mom is really ill, and my heart has been breaking this morning because my mom is really sick. I said, whoa, 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 whoa. We have a room full of Christians who believe in miracles. Would you mind if we prayed for mama? She said, would you please? And I said, yes. We all stretched our hand toward this young lady. Father, in Jesus' name, give us a miracle for mama. We weren't 30, 45 seconds in the prayer. Now, there's a lot of power in that room. 12 of them are Assembly of God pastors. I mean, they're packing something. And man, all of them, their faith was focused on it. And it got overwhelming to her. She started crying and more, and she ran out of the room. Oh, where'd she go? She was overcome by the presence of God, overcome by the miracle power of God, overcome by the love of God. I got on the plane, the Lord said, did I answer your question about Islam? I said, I think I had a good lesson here, Lord. I'll go tell the church as soon as I get back. Have a heart, have a love, love your neighbor. I don't know everybody that's watching me. I don't know all of you that are listening, but I want to close by saying this. Have you felt rejected? Have you felt like nobody loves you? Feel alone? You are not alone. We're all in the same boat. We all battle with rejection. We all battle with loneliness. But I'm going to ask you as I closed to have an aha moment. Aha. Somebody say aha. A-H-A. A stands for awareness. Just be aware. You that are outside the faith, just study it. Get honest before God and say, God, if you're really there, if Jesus is really the way, would you reveal your power to me? Secondly, H, humble yourself. Humility. As long as you have pride, as long as you have hatred, as long as you have bitterness, you're pushing God away. But the moment you humble yourself and say, you know what? I'm not that smart anymore. I need some help, Lord. And the last A, awareness, humility, address all your needs at the cross. Bring all your stuff to the cross. There's nothing that the cross cannot heal. If you're away from God, you don't have a clue who you are in God, or you're mad at your mom-in-law, you cannot stand your boss, you need Jesus. You need Jesus. Matter of fact, I'm going to ask you to do something. Would you all stand with me right now? We're going to pray a prayer, and then we're going to sing a song, and then we're going to go home. If you're in this room, or you're watching by podcast, you're picking us up in the airwaves, you're sitting in that jail cell, you're driving up the road, however you're listening to me, I want to invite you to the cross. I want to invite you to the life-changing experience of Jesus forgiving all of your sin. I want you to bow your hearts in this room, church. If you're here in this room and you say, Pastor Mike, I'm not right with God. I need to get to the cross myself, and I need to bow down and invite Jesus to be my Lord. We're going to do that. We're not going to ask you to come to the front. We're just going to let you stand there right where you are. We're going to all pray together. You that are online, you can pray with us. 30-second prayer that will change the rest of your life. If you're in this room, you say, Pastor Mike, I need to get right with God. Just raise your hand there right where you are. Sort of wave at me. That's me, Pastor. Yes, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. You up in the upper deck, God bless you. You, God bless you, sir. Anybody else? God bless you, ma'am. Thank you. God bless you, young lady. Thank you over there. Thank you, sir. Thank you up there. God bless you. You can put all, thank you, ma'am. You can put all your hands down. We're going to pray a prayer. You that are online, this prayer is going to acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord, and this prayer is going to invite Him to be number one. But the best thing is all your sins get forgiven in a second. Let's pray it together, church. Lord Jesus, I invite you to be Lord of my life. I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. Please save me, Lord. Please forgive all my sins. I invite you to be in my heart. And from this day forward, I'm going to walk with God. I need help. Fill me with your spirit. Tell me what to do. I'm all yours, Lord. I love you, Jesus. Somebody said amen. Amen.